This week on Maker Update, a water-powered power saw, solving the mystery of missing mittens, VFDs, and a tall drink of PETG. Hello and welcome back to Maker Update, the show where we keep you up to date on all the cool things that makers are making. I'm Tyler Weingartner, and I hope you're all doing great. I don't know about you, but I'm enjoying the steady change into autumn as we get ready for the spooky season. We've got another awesome show for you, so let's get going with the project of the week. There's probably a lot of tools we take for granted. I know I'm surely guilty of that. So it's great to see what it looks like to recreate some of our most used tools from scratch. That's what How to Make Everything is doing in this project of recreating Leonardo da Vinci's sawmill based on a few recovered sketches. The sawmill consists of five basic parts. There's the water wheel, which harnesses flowing water to provide power to the machine. There's the structure that serves as the overall frame, and the saw that takes care of the all-important business of cutting. Then there's the crank mechanism, which turns the rotation of the water wheel into the reciprocating motion of the saw. And finally, there's the sled, which carries the lumber through the blade. This is moved by a ratchet mechanism, so that it moves methodically through the cut, and it can't back out. Now, if you're not familiar with How to Make Everything, it's a channel that approaches every project from scratch. They may not build all the tools they need to make the tools they need in this video, but they've all been built by the team here, like this treadle-powered bandsaw that they're using to cut the ratchet wheel, or the nails that they're hand forging for the assembly. As a proof of concept, the sawmill is a total success. Ironically, the part that failed in their test for the sake of the video is the water pump that simulated the river that would be powering the water wheel. If all else fails, blame technology. I'm being a bit flippant here, but this is a fascinating look into the origins of the tools we use and what goes into making them. And this project is an impressive breakdown of them. Time for more projects. If you're not great at table tennis, sometimes it can feel a bit more like a track meet. At least, that's how Ruby Zoom feels when she spends most of her time chasing wayward balls, and that's why she made this human wearable backstop for ping pong balls. But this wasn't her first version of the project. No, no. This is the story of having an idea, failing at it, and reinventing it from the ground up. The first version of it was going to be an inflatable barrier that she could wear that would stop the ping pong balls in their tracks. After a lengthy gluing session, lots of failed inflations, and a semi-successful inflation test, she went back to the drawing board. Which is how she ended up with this design, a net of material, a tent pole to extend it outwards, and a backpack made from the box that it shipped in. The important thing is that it works, and that she didn't give up on the idea. It might look a bit silly, but it doesn't look too cumbersome to save her from the effort of chasing wayward ping pong balls. And it has just enough of that Wile E. Coyote approach to engineering to inspire others. And I love seeing projects like this. Over on Instructables, I found this project called Find My Cat by Chitlange, Sahas. This one does pretty much what it says on the tin. It's a wearable for your furry friend to help you find them when they're lost. There are commercial versions of this, but what I love is that Chitlange created this because none of those felt like viable solutions for him. They were too unreliable, or the battery didn't last long enough, or they weren't open source. This project updates the pet's location through GPS and Bluetooth, and it makes use of the Apple Nearby Interaction framework to make it easy to find your cat when they're hiding out of sight. There's a full GitHub repo for the project if you want to follow along, and a Slack channel if you want to contribute to it. And from Emily the Engineer, I found this video about extending an Ender 3 3D printer by about 10 feet on the vertical. This is one of those engineering tasks that maybe seems simple at the start, but the problems just compound the deeper you dig. She couldn't get extrusion with the same profile as the original printer, so she had to make her own rollers. Of course, if you're going to extend your Z-axis by 10 feet, you also need 10 feet of every wire that connects to the extruder. And so on and so on. It's no surprise that with a bed slinger working at this height, there's a ton of Z-wobble. But what is surprising is how well it works in vase mode, which has enabled these hilariously tall hats and Among Us figurines. Maybe a cursed idea from the start, but a fun video to see this project taken to its logical conclusions. Time for some tips and tools. From the tool scientist, I found this video on reverse engineering the RedLink protocol, which is used for Milwaukee-branded chargers to communicate with their own batteries. Tool manufacturers are always coming up with clever ways to make DC charging circuit proprietary, and this one is no exception. But you get to see how an engineer uses a logic analyzer to interpret the handshaking signals that would throw off other batteries. The science in this one is really fun, since you get to see him testing different charging scenarios like overheating batteries, freezing batteries, and more. And in the latest of Gareth's Tips, Tools, and Shoptails newsletter, we have another collection of great tips, including an info dump from Adam Savage about machinist's markup fluid, a tip from Blondie Hacks on how to do your own powder coating at home, and two tips for getting a little bit more utility out of plastic 5-gallon buckets, either using them as a dustpan or a sawhorse. Check it out. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, Sean Himmel has another installment in his series on PID controllers. This time it's all about how to tune a PID controller for an inverted pendulum. As Sean calls it, an inverted pendulum is a rite of passage for roboticists. It's an unstable system that's ripe for being managed by an automated controller. It takes input from the encoder to report on the position of the pendulum, and the stepper motor is the output. There's a ton of code up front, but the real fun in this one is when Sean starts testing the performance and analyzing the plots generated by the sensors. It's a great way to visualize what's going on in a PID system. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you did, give us a thumbs up, leave us a comment, and make sure you subscribe so you won't miss the next one. As always, huge thanks to DigiKey for making this show possible and to you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.